Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Immortal Bind, written by Traci Harding and read by Edwina Wren. The dedication reads, "For my mother, watching over me from the celestial realms, and my father watching over me on earth, with love and gratitude for this life and all your guidance." Acknowledgements. The Immortal Bind was born of a film script entitled Chairs that I wrote before I penned my first novel. Back then, many people worked very hard towards seeing this epic story realised as a feature film, and although we never got there, it has never been forgotten. I have been asked numerous times since why I never penned Chairs as a novel, as this story was the first to embody my interest in the esoteric mysteries, history, and fantasy. It seems only fitting that after writing 19 books in the same vein, the story that started it all will be reborn as book number 20. The Mayans believe in 20-year cycles, so The Immortal Bind is a full-circle moment for me. This was without question my mother's favourite story, and I regret that she will never get to read this version. Yet, I suspect her spirit is behind the new ending to this tale, which I never did get quite right in the film script. I want to thank all my family and friends for all their support over the years, along with Selwa Anthony Management and my team at HarperCollins Publishers, who do a fabulous job of producing my books for you all to enjoy. I also want to say how grateful I am to all my readers who keep buying my books, reviewing them, and recommending them to others. You have no idea how much I appreciate all your support and encouragement. I am truly blessed. I hope you enjoy this new adventure. Namaskar. A person consists of desires, and as is his desire, so is his will. And as is his will, so is his deed. And whatever deed he does, that he will reap. Brihadaranyaka, Upanishad, 7th century BCE. The Eyes of Karma. It is difficult to pinpoint where this story actually began. No tale truly has a start or an end. There is always that which went before, and more that shall follow after. Even birth is not the beginning, nor conception, for there are myriad lives and incarnations that preceded this, along with the forgotten karma that is carried forth from those experiences. Not all these lives are in human form, as there are many paths a soul might take in an attempt to nullify the effects of past deeds and disentangle from the reincarnation cycle of the earthly realms that the Hindu and the Buddhist call samsara. Sometimes it is not even our own actions that keep us embedded in the life, death, rebirth cycle, yet we are glamoured by our entanglements with others. Our desires and passions fate us to return for another round of experience. However, if this story was to be traced all the way back to the beginning, then it would take us to an ancient temple on the western coast of Gujarat, India. This holy temple, one of many shrines erected to honour the Lord Shiva, was destroyed and rebuilt several times over by Islamic kings and Hindu kings, respectively. In one of this temple's Hindu incarnations, there stood a large statue of the Lord Shiva, the supreme being who, among his many attributes, is the dispenser of karmic law and justice. The eyes of the statue were inset with two large and very rare lilac diamonds, together known as the Eyes of Karma. Devoted Shaivites who paid homage at the temple would offer gifts to the grand effigy in the hope they would learn how to free themselves from the cycles of samsara and join the enlightened in the realm of Brahman. When an oracle of the temple gazed into the Eyes of Karma on behalf of an earnest querent, the oracle would be granted visions of lives past, and upon learning of the querent's misdeeds, would relate the cause of their current woes. Thus the querent could, through right action, attempt to counteract their past wrongs and nullify or at least lessen their karmic debt. In the statue's forehead above the eyes of karma was a third eye, inset with a larger white diamond known as the Eye of Wisdom. For where the right and left eyes of Shiva represented the Lord's activity in the physical realm, his third eye was focused on the spiritual realm and had the power to annihilate evil. Wrongdoers of the Hindu faith feared the Lord's third eye, and thus wisdom protected the holy secrets of karma from abuse by the uninitiated. Above the large sandalwood gates at the entrance to the temple was inscribed an additional warning in the form of a curse. Whosoever should defy the Eye of Wisdom, to misuse or displace the eyes of karma, his lifetime shall not exist on earth. He shall be miserable and persecuted. He will witness karma's downward spiral as his curse preys upon others unaware, until the eyes of the great transformer again reside in Somnath. Late in the 10th century, the temple was raided by Afghans from across the Thar Desert. They were Muslims, and unperturbed by the curse, they destroyed the Hindu place of worship. Whether the Afghans took the treasures as spoils, the oracles of the temple secreted them away, or a third party seized the opportunity to steal the treasures during the chaos, is unknown. What became of the Eye of Wisdom is also unclear, but the Eyes of Karma resurfaced in Byzantium decades later, which is where I had the misfortune of being glamoured by their allure. As I was a famed oracle, they must have seemed the ideal gift for me, and at the time, no one knew the beautiful jewels carried a hefty curse. This was a fact that would take me the rest of that lifetime to deduce, by which time my fate was sealed by the wheels of harmful karma I had already set in motion. London. A storm raged outside the tall windows of the studio, battering the glass with frequent bursts of wind and rain. Even seated beneath the skylight, John was having difficulty seeing the effect of his brushstrokes upon the canvas, although the almost constant flash of lightning was helping. As determined as he was to stay entranced in his creation, the natural daylight was diminishing rapidly, and John was forced to lay down his brush to go switch a light on. He returned to sit before the canvas resting on its easel and smiled, pleased with how the piece was progressing. It was unusual for him to paint a portrait, especially one of a fictitious subject. The other pieces he'd painted for his forthcoming exhibition were far more avant-garde. The unknown woman taking form on his canvas was very beautiful. If she were of flesh and blood, John considered he'd rather fancy her. "You've come rather a long way since yesterday," he commented, "although from whence you came is something of a mystery."
"Are you chatting to the timbers again, Trussler?"
John's attention was diverted to the entrance of the studio, where his agent, Simon Dobbs, now stood, appearing concerned.
"I think you need to get out more. Mingle with some living matter for a change."
The volume of the storm was such that John hadn't heard his agent enter the building. Simon had his own key to John's apartment, as the studio was located on the third and top floor of the city terrace, and this arrangement saved disturbing John from his work to answer the door, located two flights of stairs below. Simon looked every bit the stylish man about town in his expensive designer suit and shoes, his slicked back blonde hair and twinkling blue eyes.
"I'm surprised you braved coming out in this deluge. You'll ruin your pretty threads."
John felt fortunate to have such representation, as his ripped old jeans and paint-splattered sweatshirt weren't going to impress anyone.
"The suit is fine," Simon turned about to model it. "The coat I left downstairs is going to need a good dry clean, though." He placed his briefcase aside on a chair ahead of approaching his client. On the subject of mingling... Ah. John raised a finger to caution against proceeding. I detest that subject. But you're turning 30 this week, Simon appealed. You can't just let a milestone like that slip by unheralded. Just watch me, John said. This exhibition is less than a month away. The last thing I need right now is a party. The last thing? Really? Simon screwed up his nose, unconvinced. It's your job to head off distractions, John insisted, picking paint off his hands so that he didn't have to observe his friend's disappointment. So it will prove to your advantage not to create any. Not wanting to hear any more on the matter, John headed for the sink to wash the paint splatter off properly. He realized Simon meant well. His agent was a social creature, and although he, like John, was still a bachelor at 30, Simon never lacked for female company or a date. John, on the other hand, rarely dated, preferring to nurture his craft, which was a solitary art that left little time or scope for a serious relationship. As difficult as it was for Simon to understand, John rather enjoyed his own company and was becoming more and more reclusive as the years rolled on. This piece is rather left of centre for you, isn't it, John? John continued scrubbing his hands with a rag as he wandered back to find Simon staring at the portrait. You're not turning conventional on me, I hope. Abstract pays much better. She's beautiful, don't you think? John admired his work anew from beside his agent. I guess so. Simon eyed the good-looking blonde. Who is she? I have no idea. The statement came out sounding rather more intrigued than John would have liked, and looking to his agent, he found that Simon's concerned expression had returned. It's just a painting. But why a portrait? That was actually a good question. I just felt like painting it. He blew it off as a creative whim, which was exactly what it was. I don't question my muses, I just go where they lead. Simon, who did not have a creative bone in his entire body, was clearly still perplexed. It's not a concern, John concluded. He liked the work and really wasn't interested in anyone else's thoughts. I'm sure you didn't brave that storm just to check on my progress. Ah, yes. Simon slapped his hands together, glad of a change in subject. I've just come from a meeting with the general manager of the gallery, and she is so impressed with the works you've completed thus far. I can't tell you how excited they are to be hosting this event. When Simon began talking promotion, John's mind tuned out. He really did appreciate all Simon's efforts on his behalf, but he paid him to take care of the business side of things because John didn't have the slightest interest in it. His sights had drifted back to the half-finished portrait, which he found far more fascinating. As Liz emerged from the bathroom, having soaked off the day's chill in a hot bath, she was drawn to the view from her 12th-floor hotel room window, which afforded a stunning outlook of the city still being lashed by the storm. Now I remember why I relocated to Australia. She towel-dried her long auburn hair while considering herself lucky not to be one of the poor unfortunates still braving the weather on the street down below. She tossed the towel aside to retrieve a cigarette from her gold case, which she lit with a matching lighter, and took a deep, satisfying drag. After savouring the moment, Liz exhaled the smoke and collapsed into a chair. This was just to be a fleeting visit to London to shop for fabrics, visit a few potential buyers, and check out the latest and greatest at Fashion Week. But the plan had changed somewhat in the past few days, and her business partner was going to be both ecstatic and devastated when she informed her of the altered agenda. Well, there's no point delaying. She placed her cigarette in the ashtray and opened her laptop to video chat with her partner, Sara Dash, back in Oz. It must have been 2 a.m. in Australia, so Liz was rather surprised to find that Sara was still online. Her partner took a while to answer and was a little bleary-eyed when she did.
Hey, Liz.
We hope you enjoyed this preview.
To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.